Pastor Kathleen Stolz and the entire congregation here. It's good to see you this morning. I want to share with you just a couple of announcements here as we're getting started. I encourage you to take a look through the bulletin. There's always lots of things going on and maybe different ways that you could get involved. So I encourage you to take a peek. And two things I want to lift up. First thing is we're continuing this. We're on the third of four offerings of what we're calling our Courageous Conversations, as in the lead up to what's happening at General Conference at the end of February, where General Conference is going to be making some decisions about the inclusion of LGBTQ persons within the life of the church. And we're having some conversations around these questions in our local church as a way of just kind of seeing where everybody is and kind of having a sense of, you know, we're together in this. And so I encourage you to come out. The next one of these that we have scheduled is going to be happening on Thursday at 7. So we encourage you to come out and join us for that. I want to thank everybody who's come out to the ones we've hosted so far. And we've really appreciated being able to have those conversations and the engagement that we've had with you. So hope that you'll come and join us. Also hope that you'll come and join us on Monday, February the 4th. Bishop Scholl is going to be here, the Bishop of the Greater New Jersey Annual Conference, to talk with us a little bit about the proposals that are coming to our General Conference and to answer your questions about them. And we're going to be inviting other local Methodist churches as well. So we hope that you'll come out for one or more of those events. Second thing that I want to do is lift up a couple of mission opportunities that we have coming up. One is where you give something and one is where you get something, and both of them are pretty good. So the first one is the giving portion, and during this coming month we're going to be receiving donations of toiletries that will support the Interfaith Homeless Outreach Council, and they'll be bundled into bags and boxes, and I hope that you'll take a look in the bulletin for some guidelines on that. We're going to be doing that collection through the end of February. The other thing that's going on is the Sarah Circle, the United Methodist Women, is making their chocolate-covered pretzels, and those are for sale, and I think the order deadline is next weekend. Those donations will go to support the Christian Caring Center in Pemberton. So you have opportunities to give something, you have an opportunity to get something, and all of it goes to support some of the work and missions that we're doing. So we hope that you'll take advantage of those opportunities. And I think that those are all the announcements, and I want to just turn it over to Nate.
Thanks, Joe. Good morning, everyone. I invite you to our time of worship. Please stand with us as you're able. We're going to sing a couple songs together.
With all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with your mind, with all your strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. With all my heart, up enter in the presence of a faithful God, the Father of an endless love. Let us praise the King. Let us praise the King of glory.
Here in this moment.
Here in this moment. Here in our lives. Now and forever. Be glorified.
Come on, we're singing. Lord, I need you.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing. Thank you.
You. That was wonderful. So as we continue this series that we've been doing about healthy relationships, today our topic is boundaries, and I'll say just a little bit about that in just a second. But I want to encourage the ushers now to come around, and they're going to share with you the red attendance pads. Those red attendance pads are the things that we use to kind of let us know that you've been here. And especially if you're visiting with us, down at the bottom of the page, there's a space that you can share your contact information. We would love to let you know about things that are going on here at the church. We do a monthly newsletter and a weekly email. And so if you'd be willing to share your contact information, we'd love to be able to let you know about some of those activities and things that are going on here. I want to say about boundaries here as we get started. One of the things that a preacher doesn't have a lot of control over is the way that external things kind of impinge on what you're going to be preaching about. And, you know, you can plan series of months or, you know, several months in advance. And so we lay out this schedule and say, okay, we're going to preach about boundaries. Well, little did we know that we would literally be preaching about boundaries in a moment when the government is shut down over a dispute about boundaries, right? Now, I cannot say the things that I'm going to be talking about today really have much of any bearing on relationships between countries and boundaries between nations. But I can say that the things we're going to be talking about today, I think, are kind of fundamental to our understanding of relationships and how relationships work. And in particular, this kind of dance that happens between closeness and distance in relationships. And this question of how two me's, when you put them together, can become a we. You know, we spend a lot of time in the church talking about, and especially, you know, think about Martin Luther King Jr. weekend, right? The idea of we, that's kind of a primary idea that the church is about. So what does it mean to be we instead of just me? And so I realize on some level this whole question of boundaries is kind of an uncomfortable one. It's an uncomfortable conversation for us to have in the church. But I think it's important. And I think it bears on so many things that we deal with. So I'll leave you to figure out, you know, some of the other implications of what we're talking about today. But I really do want to keep the focus kind of on this idea of relationships and what it means to navigate boundaries within the context of our relationships. So as we do that, I'm going to invite Tina. Tina was already to read the scripture, so here she comes. She's ready.
Good morning. Today's reading is from Proverbs chapter 8, verses 1 and then 22 to 32. Does not wisdom call, and does not understanding raise her voice? The Lord created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of long ago. Ages ago, I was set up, at the first, before the beginning of earth. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no springs abound with water, before the mountains had been shaped, before the hills, I was brought forth. When he had not yet made earth and fields, or the world's first bits of soil, when he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, when he made firm the skies above, when he established the fountains of the deep, when he assigned the sea its limits, so that the waters might not transgress his command. When he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was beside him, like a master worker, and I was daily his delight, rejoicing before him always, rejoicing in his inhabited world, and delighting in the human race. And now, my children, listen to me. Happy are those who keep my ways. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks.
Thank you, Tina. Let's take a moment now and let's pray together. God, we thank you for all your gifts to us. We thank you for your work in our lives. We thank you for the privilege of gathering together as a community to think about the word that you've given us, to think about what it means to live in community with other people. Lord, we are grateful for your work in our lives and how much you love us. We just pray your wisdom to be with me and to be with all of us right now. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So Stephanie will remember this well. The first church that I served, outside the house, there was a sign. And the sign said, Methodist Parsonage. And what happened as a result of having that sign was, people would show up at your house at all different times. Now, it didn't help that the office was also in the house, of course. But the fact that you had that sign outside meant that people would show up. People you didn't know. All times. You never knew. And frequently at the most inconvenient moments. Well, one day, after I'd been there for a couple of years, the sign was starting to look pretty bad. I took the sign down to be refurbished. I never found anybody to refurbish it. You know, I just couldn't find anybody to do that. I looked at a Google Earth of that house. The sign is still gone. So I'll encourage those pastors to thank me later. Now it's true, absolutely true, the church is in the business of helping people. But at some point, you know, it felt like there's got to be a time and a place where you can shut the door and say, okay, I'm turning the porch light off. No more trick-or-treaters, right? And maybe this story makes me sound like kind of a jerk. But honestly, that's exactly the point. Frequently, we have trouble figuring out where our boundaries ought to be. And we have trouble setting boundaries with other people. Why? Because we don't want to sound like jerks. That's why it's hard. And yet we know that it needs to be done. We know that it needs to be done. When we don't set boundaries with people, then what happens is we're inviting them to be jerks to us. Right? So you can take your pick. Either you can sound like a jerk, or you can invite somebody else to be a jerk to you. Now, you probably have experienced this with a boss, maybe at some point in your life. A boss who was continually calling you on your day off, or maybe texting you while you're on vacation. You know, somebody told a story about, you know, they were always getting a text in church, right? Continuously, every Sunday morning. Now, I was just reading an article, and it kind of put it this way. There are certain things that you don't owe your boss. One is your family. Another one is your health. Another one is your sanity, right? Nobody pays you enough money to buy all of your time. Now, I know sometimes that's easier said than done. But nonetheless, it's true. You know, if you've lived with a boss who does these things or hands you an assignment consistently at 5 o'clock, you know, and says, oh, I need you to get this done before you leave. You know what I'm talking about. But these kinds of learnings about boundaries, you know, they start early. They start probably in preschool. The idea that You know, maybe you have a friend who does not like you having other friends, right? Or maybe, you know, that friend, whenever you're with them, they require you to talk a certain way, dress a certain way, act a certain way that you are not comfortable with, that just doesn't represent who you are. All through our lives, we're having to negotiate boundaries as part of relationships. It's kind of a fundamental lesson that all of us need to learn. When we think about what it means to go through adolescence, the idea of parents and kids arguing with each other during that period of time, that's kind of a punchline to a million jokes. And it is because it's true. Now, sometimes we'll talk about it like this. We'll say, well, they're pushing their boundaries, which is true. But at the same time, another way to view it is from exactly the opposite perspective, which is to say, they're learning to set your boundaries on you as a parent and saying, this is what I'm about. And you don't have as much control over me as you think you do. The idea of setting boundaries and negotiating them, it's just part of what it means to grow up. And I would say that it's actually part of the created order. This is how we're wired. This is how the whole world was made, actually. And I can make that argument. I can start the whole way back in Genesis if you'd like me to. So let's go back to Genesis chapter 1. So Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. Says this. Actually, starting 1:1. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void. A formless void. Now, this phrase in Hebrew is wonderful. Tohu bohu. It's tohu bohu. Can you say that? Tohu bohu. And tohu bohu is this idea of chaos. It's a formless void. Well, why is it chaos? Well, it's chaos because there's no separation between anything. There's no place where the land begins and the sea stops. There's no place where the sky and the earth, you know, connect. It's just everything everywhere. That's what's being described here, formless void. And then, so the process of creation, a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. There was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God, what did God do between the light and the darkness? Separated the light from the darkness. God created a boundary between light and darkness. And it keeps going like that. God said, let there be a dome in the midst of the waters. So people are envisioning kind of a flat earth with this dome of the sky. Let it separate the waters from the waters. In other words, the waters above, that's where the rain came from in people's minds, from the waters below. So the whole creation is about separation. And I wanted to talk today a little bit about Proverbs chapter 8, because in the men's study that we have on Saturday mornings, we've been reading through Proverbs. And again, you have this idea of creation as separation. And so here, the way it's talked about, now this is a really interesting passage, Proverbs chapter 8. You might want to look at it. People don't 100% know what to do with it, because it kind of personifies God's wisdom as being right alongside God. You might think of it as kind of like God's plan for everything. So God has a design for everything. And that's who's speaking in this passage. Let's see. When he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep. Again, this idea that there is a boundary being established. It's the horizon. When God drew a circle on the face of the deep. That's how God establishes the horizon to the minds of ancient people, right? When he assigned to the sea its limit, so that the waters might not transgress his command. So we have this story about Noah and about the flood, and God says, no, you got to stop here. And this appears again in Job, in one of my favorite passages in the Bible. In Job chapter 38, Job goes through this whole thing, arguing with God, arguing with his friends. Then finally God speaks and says, listen, were you with me when I did all these things? Were you with me when I said to the ocean, thus far you may come and no farther, and here shall your proud waves halt? I love that idea. God is like this to the sea, right? That's it. You're done. You can't come any farther. All of this says to me that the idea of boundaries is the most natural thing in the world. Again, we don't like to talk about it. It's not kind of our, we don't think of that as our main business within the life of the church. But boundaries are important. They're important. Do you know any couples where every time you see them, they're together? Every time you see them, you never see them apart from each other. Now, on some level, you know, that's a great thing. It's something to be admired. And it's something that, you know, we look at that and we say, oh, that's wonderful. You know, they're always together. It can be taken too far. Have you ever known a couple that was more stuck together than together? Now, do you know what I mean by that? This idea of being that one can't make a decision without the other one. That there is no me and me. There's just we. That's it. Now, a couple that does everything together, if you really step back and think about it, because we know that in most relationships, you know, the decision-making isn't necessarily split 50-50, right? So you can imagine that if this couple does everything together, there's a significant portion of time where one or the other is just not happy, but maybe is not saying it. In other words, never really had the wherewithal, because they knew it would lead to a fight that they didn't want to have, a conversation that they didn't want to have, about, I really don't like going to blank, fill in the blank. I don't really like going to car shows. I don't like going antiquing, right? Whatever it is, you know, that the one is always dragging the other to. But that idea within a relationship of being able to say, this is what I like, this is what I don't like, this is what I think, here's where I disagree with you, and being able to tolerate that, that's what it means to be together and not stuck together, not fused, so that neither one can function without the other. It's kind of the difference between love and dependency. These are two different ideas, love and dependency. And one of the ways that we symbolize this is if you come to get married in the United Methodist Church and you say, I would like to do the thing where you light the unity candle. Okay, great, we can light the unity candle. One of the things that specifically says in our liturgy is that, you know, the side candles, you know, on either side, that once the couple goes and lights the center candle, you do not put out the side candles. Why not? Well, when I got married, I didn't cease being Joe. Stephanie didn't cease being Stephanie, right? We're still individuals. Together, but individuals. And that's an important part, navigating that space between what it means to be two me's trying to do we. That's the hardest thing that there is, right? The hardest thing that there is. But that's what we're called to do. That's what we're called to do. So I want to talk for just a minute here about the idea of what kinds of boundaries are we talking about? You know, what are some different forms that these boundaries take. So I think we've got a slide about that. So the first one I want to talk about is the idea of physical boundaries. Now this one should be kind of obvious, right? So when we talk about physical boundaries, what we're saying is, you know, that abuse, whether sexual, physical, you have the right to say, I don't want this. You have the control over your own body. It should go without saying, but in many cases it is not said and it doesn't happen. But it can be much more subtle than that, a lot more subtle. Think about with your kids. Think about, for a lot of parents, I know that this is something that bothers them. They get to that moment when their kid will not hold their hand anymore, right? Or as they continue to grow up, that day when they don't want you to walk them to the bus stop anymore, right? They do not want you to say, I love you in public, right? All these things are kind of like physical manifestations of boundaries. Say, okay, Here's where I begin and you end. Another one is this idea of time and effort and energy. So when you have a friend, when you have someone in your life who doesn't understand that you have about a million responsibilities, work, family, other organizations that you're involved with, the church, yourself, when you have a relationship with someone who doesn't get that you need time for all those things and keep stepping on those other things, you need to have a conversation with them about boundaries. Now, I know this idea, especially when you're talking about your boss, you know, your ability to negotiate these boundaries varies greatly depending on the strength of the job market, for example, and other things that you have going on in your life. But these are important conversations to have. The next one is this idea of decision-making and control. So all of us, at points in our lives, you know, we all grow up. When we're growing up, our parents make a lot of decisions for us, and that's perfectly fine. And when we get to the other end of our lives, sometimes we need people to help us with decisions then too. Sometimes we go through things physically or emotionally where we're not in a great place to make a lot of great decisions, and we need help. But one of the things that I think is most important, and Kathleen and I see this a lot, is this idea of people wanting to swoop in, especially for their parents and grandparents, and make decisions on their behalf. We also see it with kids, where parents are trying to make decisions on behalf of their kids and pushing them in ways that they don't want to go. And it doesn't always end up well. So this idea that you need to leave people the opportunity to make their own decisions, to be autonomous for as long as they can be. When you feel like you need to swoop in and make a decision for somebody for their own good, be very careful. And then finally, this idea of emotional boundaries. Now, I wonder if you've ever been in a situation like this where you're in a group and maybe the group doesn't know each other very well. If the group knows each other very well, typically things are fine. You know, somebody can have a little, you know, moment where they break down and have to let something out and they share it with that group, and that's perfectly fine. But there are times when you're kind of in this gathering of people that maybe hardly know each other, and all of a sudden somebody is kind of bearing their soul and everybody looks at each other like, what do we do now? Right? Now, when that happens at church, I think that we're more equipped to deal with that. But there are people, and you know some of them, who kind of are ready to open the floodgates at any time without a whole lot of thought as to who they're going to flood out when those floodgates open. You see it maybe in your Facebook feed. I mean, I literally have seen people just kind of have breakdowns over Facebook. And that's hard. And it's hard for folks to kind of come back into a relationship with those, with people around them. It can be done, but it's hard. Now, by the same token, this idea of too many of us set our boundaries really high. We don't share anything with anyone. I see that sometimes in the church too, and that's one of the things that's challenging. It's kind of like you want to be part of the church and you want to have a supportive community around you. You won't even tell us when you're in the hospital, right? How can we help if we don't know what's going on? Some people live their lives that way. They're very private. But what you're doing sometimes is you're keeping people who can help you from helping you. It's hard. And my hope for everyone is that you've got a place where you can go and safely share what it is that you're struggling with, whether that's with your spouse, whether that's, you know, with your adult child, you know, with your parent, with a grandparent, with a best friend that's been with you forever, you know, wherever that is, in a small group. You know, there are people where this is kind of our thing. you know, pastors, therapists, sometimes hairdressers and bartenders, right? Kind of the same thing. But it's important to have that place and to know when to share and when not to. One of the things that I want to say is a little word about boundaries with respect to the way that women grow up. One of the challenges is that we teach young women to please people, that they're kind of responsible for making the people around them happy, for not upsetting people, especially the men in their lives. And this makes it really hard, you know, as an adult then, to be able to negotiate and set boundaries. But I really want to encourage you, if you have trouble with boundaries, to think in terms of these four categories, and really to be able to negotiate, to be able to speak up for yourself and say, this is what I want, this is what I don't want. It's incredibly important. Everybody needs to do it. It's a fundamental part of what it means to be human. Because what we're really saying is, God created me as an individual who is beloved, unique, unrepeatable in the history of the world. And God created you that way too. Every single one of us. Never has been before, never will be again. And what that means is that I'm asking to be treated with respect. And you too ought to be asking to be treated with respect and with love. That's what we're talking about when we're talking about boundaries, is learning to respect the other person is also a child of God. And especially here on this weekend when we celebrate Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, when we think about the civil rights movement, one way to talk about it is a way of a people to say, here are the boundaries, and I demand that you respect my humanity. That's really one way to talk about what the civil rights movement was about. I don't want to have to be sitting in the back of the bus. I don't want to have to use a separate water fountain. I don't have to want to be prohibited from voting or be denied equal justice under the law. The idea that we recognize one another's humanity and respect it. That's what we're really talking about when we're talking about boundaries. And that's why they're important to us, and why we have to practice living into this thing that's part of the order of creation. So let's take a minute and let's pray together about it. God, we recognize that we're not always good at understanding where we end and where someone else begins. And likewise, we're not always good about telling people, you know, what we are happy and comfortable with and places where we're not happy and comfortable. Sometimes we are too guilty of going along to get along. Would remind us that boundaries are part of the world that you created, that they enable us to live in community, that they enable us to respect one another's humanity. Lord, we are grateful for the way that you're at work in our lives, and we pray for wisdom as we think about how we can practice this, not only today, but in the days and weeks to come. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So this week, I am looking forward to a meeting that Bethany is our youth director, that Bethany and I are having with someone from the community. So before Christmas, I was looking through my Facebook feed, and I saw that there was a mom in town here who has a son who's got a band. And one of the questions she was asking to people on Facebook here in Medford was, where can my son's band play? And they're in middle school, and so bars aren't really an appropriate place for them to play. And so I was thinking about the fact that there are these like 3,000-watt subwoofers under the stage that we probably don't use quite enough, right? And thinking about that. And so we started a conversation back and forth about the idea of maybe doing an open mic night for young people here in this space. And so I'm pretty excited about that idea. We're looking at doing that in March. And so as that time comes forward, we'll need some help with that, some people to, you know, just hang around and provide hospitality and all that kind of stuff. But I'm really looking forward to this. This is exactly one of the ideas that that was in our minds when we built this place, to have these kinds of conversations. So again, in a couple weeks, we're going to have a celebration of the ministry possibilities that have become available to us as a result of what we've done here. And so on the 3rd of February, we're inviting you to come and join us for one special service here in this space at 10 o'clock in the morning. We're just going to have one service that day, and it's going to involve all the dimensions of our music and our liturgy happening here to celebrate the conclusion of our capital campaign. And so if you haven't yet completed your pledge, you made a commitment to the capital campaign and it's not quite completed, we'd love to have you think about how you can complete that in the next couple weeks. At that service, we're going to be announcing the total that we've received. We also have some other special surprises for you. I personally am excited because we only have about $100 left to go on our campaign pledge. So we're right there and ready to close it out. And if you haven't made a contribution, we invite you to do so. It will help us to make sure that our mortgage is as low as what we can get it as we move to our permanent financing. So whether you give electronically, whether you give by putting something in the offering plate, we just want to thank you for your support of the ministry of this church. And especially if you are visiting with us today, we want to say a word to you just to say that you are our visitors, you are our guests, you don't need to feel obligated to put anything in the plate. Happy to see you and look forward to seeing you again. Let's continue now with our offering.
Thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song, sing my flaming tongues above. The mountains I'll fix upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise, my Ebenezer, hear the to
So I invite you now to join me with me in prayer. We'll take a few moments of silence, and as we go, I'll invite you and give some space for you to lift up your own concerns and things that you're praying about today. So let's take some time now to go to God in prayer. Lord, you have given us all things. You lead us and you guide us even when we feel like we're wandering. Lord, we trust that somehow you're at work behind the scenes to bring things together. Lord, on this weekend when we celebrate the life of someone who reshaped our country for the better, great servant of your justice, Lord, we recognize that there's so many ways in which we still fail to live into that idea, that dream of equality. Lord, we pray that we might recommit ourselves as individuals, as a church, to recognizing the dignity the value of every human being, regardless of any thing that differentiates us on the outside. We are grateful for the legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. As we're gathered here this morning, we think about people we know, people we love who are struggling. People who need to have a word spoken into their lives of hope, of strength, of encouragement, of healing. Who are the people and what are the situations that you want to lift before the Lord today? Whether we speak names aloud, whether we speak them in the silence of our hearts, we know that you hear us, that you always hear us. So, Lord, we pray today for people who are dealing with crises of health, people who are dealing with crises in their families, in their finances, at their work. Lord, we pray for courage and strength to be able to face every trial and every challenge, knowing that you are a God who walks with us, who holds us up, who encourages us, who never fails us. Lord, we are grateful for your power at work in our lives. We give you thanks for all the good things that you've poured into us. And we pray for those who are hurting today. Lord, we lift our prayers to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you now to stand with us as we close. We're going to sing, "We'll Understand It Better," by and by.
We are tossed and driven on a restless sea of time. Somber skies and howling tempests all succeed a bright sunshine. In the land of perfect day, when the mists are rolling away, we will understand it better by and by.
Come on, let's
go. Oh, by. saints of God are gathered home.
Thank you. So we go forth in this place trying to understand how two me's can come together and be a we. And it's not always easy. We go forth knowing that God has given us this gift of boundaries to help us define where we end and where someone else begins, recognizing that we are both beloved children of God, to be respected, to be loved. Go forth in the love and the grace and the power of Jesus Christ. Amen. We do have to put the chairs away today.